Hi, April, and welcome to the IELTSpodcast.com essay corrections service. Thank you very, very much for sending this in to us. It already looks quite good. What we do with these single essay corrections, if we quickly run over them and give you some useful advice, some tips. But I must say that in order to progress properly through IELTS, repetition is important. In order to get from a 7 to an 8, for instance, you really are required to reduce errors in your writing to almost none. Once we're at that point, we can really start thinking about coming out with a 7.5 or above overall. But perfection really is key. And in order to achieve perfection, you need to develop the skills of a proofreader, which takes quite some time and quite a lot of writing tasks to be completed. So today is more about providing you with some overall general guidelines of where to aim for. But if you would like to continue receiving our support on your essays, we do have a complete course available online. The link is in the email that I've sent. So let's begin reading. So the chart illustrates the number of pet owners in 6 different countries. This is not an IELTS specific thing, this is a me thing. I don't like brackets in academic essays. You can, of course, use brackets in any writing to expand a category. So what's the category? 6 different countries. What are those countries? These. Of course it makes sense. But for me, it breaks up sentences and it causes people to have to stop and go, wait, what? So I would if you want to specify the countries, I would just take this out and say, the chart illustrates the numbers of pet owners in Wales, Canada, America, Ireland, Scotland and England between 1990 and 1998. Overall, it can be seen that England has the most number of people, I would say, the highest number. Yeah, it's the highest number. Overall, it can be seen that England has the highest number of people owning a pet. So that would be my grammatical correction for that clause of that sentence to make it slightly more precise and a bit smoother. While Wales has the least number of pet owners. Cool. It is also clear that the trend of pet ownership is consistently rising from 1990 to 1992 and then fluctuates over the rest of the period. I would say throughout the remainder of the period. In academic essays, we use language that's as specific and as precise as possible. So general terms like rest and over, although they do the job, it's much better to be as specific as possible. But the fact that you've got things like consistently rising fluctuates throughout the remainder of the period. These are very good sentences to include, so well done. So this here feels very inappropriate because we've already begun. So to in the middle of a thing to say to begin is just, it throws you off. It feels like then all of this was worth nothing, that it wasn't supposed to be there. But it was. So take that out entirely. Also, this is unnecessary. So this sentence could just be, English people accounted for the largest number of animals kept. Or, English people accounted for the largest number of domesticated animals. So if we're trying to think of all of the ways we could refer to pets, domesticated animals is an excellent phrase to use. So English people accounted for the largest number of domesticated animals, reaching a peak, I would say, a peak of over 900,000 pets or animals in 1994. Wales, however, experienced the opposite, or demonstrated the opposite, or I think experienced the opposite might be okay, actually. It's too colloquial. A hair below is a subjective definition. None of us can say what that is. And an academic essay is always communicating exactly what something is. So if you ever find yourself using ambiguous colloquial terms like this, remove it and do something else. Because the thing about your writing here is it's quite good. You have you have a smooth flow. You clearly are quite experienced. I think I can see that you are an ESL teacher, so that would be why. But a hair below is not an academic phrase, and we should stay away from those. So that's still good. On the other hand, the number of pet owners in England experienced a minor drop in 1993, with approximately 830,000 people owning pets. However, this figure reached... I should have explained that. This is a preposition. People with pets is fine. The preposition explains the relationship between the people and the pets. But I would rather use a verb there. So people owning pets. Keep it specific. However, this figure reached a sudden increase, or suddenly increased, or experienced a surge, a sharp rise, the following year, remove the brackets please, in 1994, and then dropped dramatically or drastically. If you're going to use this one, I would say drastically dropped rather than dropped drastically, because here you're asking people to pronounce two D's together, dropped drastically, and it's not very nice for an English speaker to have to do. So let's say drastically dropped, because then it can come straight out of the mouth without any trouble. To 780,000, again, in 1995. This number had remarkably gone up and fluctuated, or... we've already said fluctuated, so what else could we say? Now, what I would actually comment on this last sentence is the word remarkably is sort of additional information. This task tests your ability to extract information from a graph. So, the fact that it's remarkable is an opinion. It is information not contained in the graph. So we should strive to stay away from keeping that. We need to keep our opinion out of these tasks. I think we should be more specific here, because when we say this number, we've actually referred to two numbers in this paragraph, and a couple of years, and a couple of other things. And so I think when you've got this much information here, we need to refer specifically to it so that we know what you're talking about. So either refer to the fact that it's English pet owners, or repeat the number. But in this instance, I think the accuracy is more important. Cool. We reached a final figure of 870,000 pet owners in 1998, or by 1998. But cool. So there's some general corrections, because in task one, like I said, the main thing is that you extract all of the information. You don't add any information yourself. The information is accurate. It's displayed well. And that obviously you use the correct language to do so. So have a listen through, maybe again if you like. And apply your corrections to your essay and see what it looks like then. Like I said, if you would like to continue receiving support from me and Ben via written and video corrections, you can sign up to our course below. And I've been told by Ben as well to let you know that if you sign up in the next 24 hours, you'll receive a free upgrade to the speaking and reading portions of our course also, which is obviously fantastic. So I hope to see you again soon. I hope to see your essays dropping into my inbox. But until then, April, have a wonderful day and good luck in your exam.